If you have your Bibles with you that you want to mark up, if you have your electronic Bibles, you can turn to Matthew chapter 6. And I want to read three portions of Scripture today. And it will be from the New American Standard Version of the Bible, the NASB, which is one of the most literal translations. And it says this in Matthew, the sixth chapter. This is Jesus speaking. Now, Jesus in Matthew chapter 6, let's layer this down so you see where he's at. He's in a teaching mode, and he's talking to people about different concepts. And this chapter is a power chapter, Matthew chapter 6. It's Matthew chapter 6 that you get the Lord's Prayer. They say, how do we pray? And Jesus says, this is how you're supposed to pray. And it wasn't a repetitive thing. It was, this is a way to touch heaven. And then after that, it's about fasting. And you're supposed to, if Jesus brings it up, maybe we should probably do it, fasting and not to look a little glum and make it obvious to everyone. Don't buy the t-shirt that says, I am fasting, and wear that when you're fasting. No, don't do that. And then it comes to this, talking about treasure, where your treasures are. And so If he's teaching these principles, I would suggest that this is one we need to pick up as well. And it says this, Jesus says this, do not store up for yourselves treasure on earth. Want the paraphrase version right there? Don't store stuff up in storage centers. Where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But this is where he says to store your treasures. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in or steal. And then this verse, for where your treasure is, what you put value in, what we invest in, that is where our heart will be also. My title this morning, my first title is this, what does my heart treasure? What does my heart treasure? Can you ask yourself that question? What does my heart treasure? And it can't be just what you say that it treasures, but your life, your actions, where you're giving your time, where you're pouring your income, speaks of where your treasures are. And more importantly, I think than anything, it is our time that we have to value. Now, here's my real title. Turn to somebody and get ready to say this. Sorry, Forrest, life is more than a box of chocolates. Turn to somebody on the other side and tell them, sorry, Forrest, life is more than a box of chocolates. It's more than that $19.95 you paid. This morning we stopped to get you all some Hershey Kisses when you're leaving. Grab a handful and enjoy them on the church. And as we pulled up, it was amazing because this is my favorite day to go to grocery stores and watch. There were more men running into the grocery store this morning than I ever see at any time of the year. And more men walking out with a panicked face with flowers in their hand. I don't know how they forgot to do it. And they're grabbing flowers, grabbing boxes of candy. And for one moment, we celebrate a treasured investment called love. But unfortunately, Hollywood and media has taken the idea of love and thrown it to the side, and it really is. Love is more than a box of chocolates. I ask the question rhetorically, where is your treasure? What do you put value in? What are you investing in right now? What is your life really about when you leave here on Sunday afternoon and you begin to go back to your regular days and you fill out your week? Where are you investing? What is your treasures? What is the things of value? Is it things that you're trying to collect, getting a certain amount of goods? Are there certain things that I got to have this to attain value, to feel that I have worth? Do you have to have positions and titles and places like that? Is that what you're striving for? Is that your value? Is that what your heart is after? Are you after influence, that you can influence people? That's the trendy thing right now. I want to be an influencer. There are people making hundreds of thousands of dollars just being influencers on the internet. And if you're influenced by those people, you'll have a sad, sad life. There are much better people to be influenced by than the influencers that think they are so important to this world. Are you after being like what we give our time to, what we give our finances to, is what we really value? I'm here to put in premise the things that are most valuable in our lives, to bring on this Valentine's morning this thought that what is valuable, what is important in our lives is really this. There's three things that I think that are critical. First is our souls, because it's the one thing that will last forever. As much as you might want to tan your body and change the color of your hair and put things on your skin and do whatever, the value of your body is not where your value is. It will grow old. And some of you that have tatted, and those that are tatting themselves up, I am scared to think. I am glad I'm older than most of them, because I won't live to see how ugly it will be, that picture of your mama when you're 70 and it's shrunk up on the side of your body. Oh man, that is going to be one ugly thing. Have you really thought about some of these people that get tats all the way up and down their neck, what they're going to look like when they're 70? It's like, what happened? You look like you got gangrene or something. No, it's my tattoo from when I was really cool. I apologize this morning. I normally have decaffeinated coffee, but my wife didn't get up as early as I did, and I had caffeine. My daughter Audra knew early. She said, "Dad, did you?" And I said, "Yes, I did." Your most valuable asset is your soul. It is that thing that will last forever. And unfortunately, it's the thing that sometimes we give the least energy to, the least time to, the least value to. And I'm here to recall on this morning that your treasure is your soul. The other great treasures of your life is your spouse, or those that are married, or those that are looking to be married. What you're getting ready to invest in, that person is the most valuable asset that you have. They will be with you in sickness and health, for better or than worse, unless they decide to trade you in like an old car. That's why Jesus said divorce is not right, because there's too many people trading it in too often. You have to make a decision, because you're going to have difficulties, but you're in it for better, for worse, for richer or poor, in sickness and health. And those words need to be more valued than they've ever been valued. My treasure, my investment is in my spouse. And the third thing that I must always realize is my investment are in my children. They are the future. They are the hope of the next generation. And if we don't invest in them, we're in trouble. I read recently a statement that startled me, just overwhelmed me, that the average couple spends 23 seconds in meaningful conversation each day. Happy Valentine's Day. 23 seconds. Not saying, did you put out the dog? Did you feed the cat? Did you leave the door open? Are you picking up? No, meaningful conversation. Do you remember what meaningful conversation was? It was when you were dating and you spent hours just in each other's presence. You were lost. You were googly-eyed. And people would say, oh, they're in love. Yeah. You had meaningful conversation and other stuff. Yeah, but we've lost that. And then the second part of this is one of the greatest growing areas of in society right now are daycares. And what a tragedy to bring a person into this world and then give them to somebody else to say, here, you invest in my kid. You spend the hours with them. Because I need to go chase more stuff. I need a bigger home, and I've got to have a better career because I need more stuff. And I don't want to step on anybody's toes, but I think we really need to evaluate what is the most important thing. What do we really want to invest in? And this message hit after yesterday. I did a funeral here at the church for a rich man, a really wealthy man, a man that, well, the people of this world wouldn't call Fred Graham rich because his treasures were not the treasures that our world says that you must have. I don't title sermons often for funerals, but I did. I said I met a giant. And that was the title of my message last night. Giants, you normally think of people that are in authority and in power, can wield influence and do all kinds of things. And they have positions and titles and wealth and fames and homes and cars, and they can travel. But as I evaluated Fred Graham's life last night, yesterday, and eulogized him, I realized that Fred was a wealthy man. Many here didn't understand his wealth, didn't even bother to show up for one of our great elders, one of our wealthy men in the church, because you didn't see Fred Graham with the treasure that he had in his heart. He had a treasure like nobody else. You see, many times we misconstrue wealth for things of this world when it's not the things of this world we should be chasing, but it is the things of God that we should be chasing. And this is no disrespect for Fred. They knew what they were doing, and Cindy, but they didn't have a home. They lived with Lance and Angie, so their life wasn't about home. Their children, John and Angie and Cindy, they're not fighting today over who's going to get the home. And we talked about his little silver Honda that would sit here at the church with a bungee cord on it. And we knew that he would be here praying. Nobody's fighting over Fred's Honda. I even volunteered to bring it here for about 6 months as a memorial just to remind us that Fred, when we saw that car, we knew Fred was in here praying. Fred didn't have a lot of things in this material world, but Fred was a rich man. He was a man that understood what was really valuable, that it wasn't material things, homes and our IRAs and cars. He understood Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. He understood, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And he left a treasure. Oh, he left wealth like you cannot imagine. He gave his children more than many of us will ever give his children. He gave them a heritage. He gave them something that was so valuable yesterday. And it was a life pattern that he established early in his life. He gave them an understanding of the power of prayer. Every one of those children that walked up yesterday, Angie, Cindy, John, they came up and they didn't talk about all the vacations. And they didn't talk about all the worldly things. They said, my dad gave me a love for prayer. He had a love for the house of God. He had a love for a presence. And if anybody was ever around Fred Graham, you would have to say he had a love for prayer. If he ever met you, he has called your name out more than once in prayer. We were blessed with a rich man by the name of Fred Graham that visited our world, that touched our lives, that touched his family. He left an inheritance of a family that they got something that so many I wish that others would desire to emulate, to have. As they sat there, they talked about his love for prayer, his love for people, and continual his entire life just praying that souls would come to God. That is the treasure of this life. And he every day, all of his life, not every day, but most of his life was spent just trying to touch somebody for Jesus. He understood the power of the soul being saved. He understood the value of a soul, and that's where he put his treasure. when he was nearing the end of his life, he went to visit. They told the story yesterday. It was an amazing story that he went to his local pharmacist and he had a strawberry shake, his favorite, and he was drinking the shake, and the pharmacist said, "Oh, do you have one for me?" And he said, "No, I don't, but would you like one?" And she said, "Oh, no, I can't, and insisted. And Fred turned around and left and came back later and had strawberry shakes for the entire pharmacy. Everybody got a shake because Fred understood the value of life, that the treasures. And so when Angie or Cindy, one of them went, as Fred began to get the bad report, she went to the pharmacist and said, "I'm here to pick up some medicine for Fred." And she's like, "Where is he at?" And she began to share the story. The pharmacist literally went to her face and started sobbing. The impact of a man that knew where the treasure of life is. That it's not in the things that we want to collect. It's not in the material things. It's not in the positions that we chase and the social circles that we can be a part of and the cliques that we... But the treasure of life is knowing Jesus Christ, having your soul ready for the kingdom and being a person of prayer and being a person of value. And as I looked that down this day, Fred gave his all three of his family members are involved in ministry. They're passionate about God. They show up faithfully to church. Fred, you gave the greatest treasure that you could give your family, a love for God, a love for the house of God, a love for prayer. Oh, Fred, you are a rich man. Because when you give the gift of prayer, when you pray for other people, you have to understand that the Bible says the prayers never end. Oh yeah, David, it says the prayers of David have ended. They've been stopped being spoken of. So if you never met Fred, you don't get to have a prayer that lives forever. But for almost every person that is under the sound of my voice that ever talked to Fred, he probably prayed a prayer for you. And you have to understand that prayer is reverberating back and forth, back and forth from now until Jesus comes over your life. Prayers never die. That is where your treasure should be, in the power of prayer that it has. Oh, he only spent about 5 years here, but they were the most treasured gift that any person has ever given. People have given great sums of money, and people do wonderful things for this church, but Fred would spend hours upon hours in this church praying, and the atmosphere of this church is forever changed because a rich man by the name of Fred Graham showed up and began to pour prayers in this that will relive as long after I'm gone as pastor, as you've left this church, you've left this. These prayers will stay here. The very atmosphere of this building is saturated with a man that cried out for souls, cried out for the lost, the treasure that you don't want to lose in life. Our lives has changed so much over the past few years. 2 Timothy 4:21, Paul makes this statement, and it was an interesting statement. He was talking about things that he wanted brought to him and things that he needed and people he wanted to see. And this statement was a powerful statement, but you have to understand it in the context of the day. It says this: make every effort to come before winter. Eubasus greets us, and also Purden and Linus and Claudia and all the brethren. But that first frame, make an effort to come before winter. Because when winter came up to 100 years ago, everything in life changed. Do you realize this? 100 years ago, 90% of Americans were farmers. Hard to imagine. Just less than 100 years ago, that 90% of this audience were farmers. I just read this and it overwhelmed me. Today, less than 2% of us are farmers. And I don't know that we have a farmer that sits in our midst today. That cultural shift 100 years ago that began to take place has changed and impacted our lives in more ways than we ever realized. It changed our culture. It changed the way we live. There's a shift, a paradigm shift, because we had 100 years ago, society didn't put emphasis on things. It didn't put emphasis on homes. We didn't have cars. Few had electricity. Air travel was just an imaginary thing. But our lives, we don't realize how subtly life has changed. Suddenly, everything about life is different. You see, winter, Paul understood this, winter changed things before heat, nice homes. Winter was a time that slowed everybody down. Winter was a time when the fields would go dormant, the cold and the snow would blow in, and life would come to a crawl. Winter was a time when you had to pause. So Paul was saying, winter is getting ready to come. We're getting ready to slow down life. We're going to move the pace of life down. And I need some stuff in my life and what was it? It was not the treasure of things. It was the treasure of people and the treasure of God's presence, books, things like that he wanted, because he was preparing to invest in his soul. And when we lost the winter, when our society shifted, we lost the pause of winter that allowed us to read, to reflect, to bond with our spouses, to connect with our kids. Even 50 years ago, our homes were much smaller, yet I feel like they were filled with such warmth, closeness, and thankfulness. We're privileged. I guess I look at it now. When we were married, we were provided housing at the college we worked at. And when they told us that we were going to get this home, we were just ecstatic. It was 650 square feet. And it was the greatest 650 square feet. And we lived in it for 10 years. 650 square feet. Fond times. And I look back now at that house and I realize that that house wasn't just a home, one home that was six, but that represented a culture of a time when lots of families lived. And if you look dispersed around the central Indiana, there are many small homes that are set around. I was driving through Noblesville where we live, and I looked at, there's so many smaller homes. And it's a mark. It's a remembrance. It's a reminder that there was a time that we didn't need the largest, the biggest, the greatest to have a good home. I imagine there were wonderful Thanksgiving dinners and there were wonderful conversations in those small homes. I know that in our own home for those 10 years, we have some of the fondest memories. We had parties and gatherings. We sat on floors, things that we wouldn't. We've got to have everything because we lost perspective. Somehow this world has told us that to be successful, to be blessed, we've got to have the biggest, the most, the marquee, the most influence. And I wonder if we've lost the treasure, even as Christians, that God had in place for us. We lost our focus, we lost our pace, and our treasure changed. Even in our Christian world, we think we're sacrificing. Oh, but yet we still have so much. What did we give up for that that winter pause that we had as a society? Just now, 100 years, our kids have no idea, no concept of this life. I have very little understanding of this life. There's a few in here that could tell you of that life. I'm thankful now for the heritage of a home of 650 square feet. We laugh at the things that we had did there as a family. We had both of our kids. They were 3 and 5, I believe, 2 and 4, whatever, as we had those kids. And as the house began, we had 2 bedrooms. One of them, you have closets that's bigger than the second bedroom. And we have our kids. And so we were like, what are we going to do? Well, we ended up with a 3-bedroom home. We turned our living room, which was the family room, which was also part, that we turned that into our bedroom. And Gentry got the bedroom, and Rissa got the bedroom. So we had a 3-bedroom house with a kitchen. And we loved it. You see, I'm here on Valentine's to bring us back. Am I okay this morning to bring us back? That we got to refocus and don't let mass media and marketing and television, Amazon, tell you this is what you need to be rich and this is what you need to have a great home. What you need is what you have when you show up on a Sunday morning at Life Connections and you feel the powerful presence of God and your children feel the blessed power of God. That is the heritage. That is the gift that you want to give more than any. And I hasten to a close. Matthew chapter 6. I want to give you another portion of scripture. Matthew chapter 6, verses 31 through 33. This is just before he tells you what to treasure. Look what he says. Do not worry then, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear for clothing? For the Gentiles eagerly seek all these things. But know this, for your heavenly Father knows you need all these things. We need those things. We need things to eat and drink and places to live. And I would even put in there a car to drive. But here's what he says. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. What is he saying? He says, when you get priorities right, when you get perspective right, when you get value right, all these things that you are chasing after will lose their relevance, will lose their importance, and the peace that you're longing for, and the things that you're really wanting in life, you know, they're setting right around you. It's your family, it's your kids, it's your spouse, it's being in the presence of God. When you find those treasures, all of a sudden, all the other things of this life grow strangely dim. You don't have to have the largest television, you don't have to have the latest, and I'm not here to preach. I just want to get a hold of your heart and say, where are your treasures, where are your values, what are you really investing in? If those things really made you happy, then you wouldn't need another one bigger and badder. If those things really, you would be satisfied, there would be a point of satisfaction. Well, I got this kind of car, but then, well, I got to go up to another level. Because Madison Avenue is just always driving you to the next thing. That's when you will be happy. That's when you just reach for this worldly treasure. And then Matthew chapter 13, this is the secret. This is the secret I believe Fred Graham found. Jesus says this, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in the field. It's there and it's findable. But you have to make a commitment. One, you have to go and say, I want this treasure. And I know it's there. And when the man found the treasure, he hid it. And from joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and he buys the field. Can I tell you today? Buy the field that has the real treasure. Buy in to the things that have the greatest value buy in to the things of God. I close coming back to the funeral of Fred Graham, the rich man. He was so rich. You're like, where are they at today? Where's Cindy and where's Lance and Angie and the family? You see, when you're really wealthy, you don't just have one funeral. You have two funerals. Fred Graham was so wealthy, he had to have two funerals. He had one here yesterday to celebrate the treasures that he owned. And today they're in Michigan sharing with more people. You know, he started a church way up in Michigan, and it seemed as he failed. They said he prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed, and it just fell apart, and he had to leave. But the prayers of a man that understands the value of prayer knows they never die. Come on, you have to understand that those prayers that you breathe, that you think have no power, and where is God in my prayer? They don't die. You may go to the grave and not see them answered, but they don't die. Angie came up, Pastor, because I was sharing. She's, I got to tell you. She told me this story. You told about how he prayed prayers and didn't see anything. And he said he left that city and went down to another part of Michigan. But a prayer bouncing around found a young man that had never been to church, and he came to an apostolic church and was filled with the Spirit and met a young lady. And the prayer for souls and the prayer for the church was answered years later with that young man that didn't even know Jesus Christ at the time, finding Jesus and then finding a burden, finding his own treasure in the field and something gripping his whole soul. And he went back to that town, has established a church, and they're having mighty revival. Your prayers do not die. They don't die. Keep praying for your kids. Keep investing in the right things. Did you ever realize when Moses shows up on the mountain with Jesus and the three disciples are up there and they say, it is good for us to be there, that is an answer to a prayer? It was like, wow, Elijah and Moses, that's so cool. No, it's an answer to a prayer that God couldn't answer in the moment. It goes all the way back to Exodus when Moses said to God, show me your glory. And God said, not now. I can't answer that prayer for you right now, Moses. All I can do is I'll run by in the wind, and you hide in the cleft of the rock, and I'll put my hand, and as I go by, I'll let you just see the backside, and it's going to blow you away. But don't you worry, Moses. I heard your prayer. And thousands of years later, I don't know how the bones got connected back together, but all of a sudden from the grave or from wherever, Moses, it's time for you to hear the answered prayer. Come on down on this mountain right now. I'm going to let you see me in my trance. God answers your prayers. You got to understand where your values are. It's in the things of God. They sit here. Not one of them got up here and bemoaned the fact that they were going to have to fuss and fight over the inheritance. They all talked about the inheritance that they owned. Oh, Dad gave us a rich heritage of the Holy Spirit. He spoke in tongues often. That's the heritage you want to have for your family. They talked about how he just would breathe the name of Jesus in every situation. Jesus here, Jesus there. That's the treasure that's in the field. That's what you want to have ownership of. They talked about the inheritance. They received a prayer. They talked about their heritage. heritage of their lives. And you know what was the most powerful thing? His richness went so far beyond that. When Brendan got up here, he come up here and he had his words all prepared and he was ready to say his piece, and he stood here and his mouth went mute and he shook his head and he kept turning back, so broken by the richness of his grandfather's life. That's the treasure that you want. Where your treasure is, that is where your heart will be. Oh God, stand with me this morning. Is there anybody that says, God, help me? I need a fresh vision of what is important in my life. Would you raise your hands this morning? The presence of God is in this room. Your life is more than a box of chocolate. Your life has value. Your prayers are important. Your treasures are here. I wonder if there's anybody else that would like to join those that are coming to this altar this morning just to say, God, help me. Help me to refocus my life, God. Help me to find the real treasures. I'm sorry that I've got caught up in Amazon shopping and caught up in social media, and I've given so much of my life away to my spouse and my children. Their lives are more valuable. Their lives are more valuable. That husband, that wife is leaning, longing to have time with you again. That child, they don't need another toy. They don't need another game. They need you. They need your investment. They need what the rich man gave to Cindy and Angie and John. They need a parent that says the treasure is in Jesus Christ. The treasure is in that your soul is ready for eternity. It's more than a box of chocolate. Your life has more value than the stuff that you're collecting. Where will it end up? It'll end up in a garage sale. It'll end up at Goodwill. And that's if you're lucky. Most of it will end up in a dumpster that will go to a garbage dump. Oh, and it was so important to have that car with a certain marquee on it, to live in that certain place. Those are not your values. You are a child of Jesus Christ, and your value is your relationship with your Lord. Your value is your soul. The old song says, I have decided to follow. Help us. Sorry, guys. We got 13 different versions going on here. But this is a song. Sorry, Cole, I apologize. Just Spirit said, I have decided that my treasure is in this house. My treasure is in His presence. And this old song, on a Valentine's Day, is to remind you that He loves you. He died for you. He is your treasure. Let's sing this. And if you feel led of the Spirit, just want to come and spend some time with that treasure as we're singing, altars are open.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
I have decided
to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. Sing.
last few weeks, months, been some hard times here in life. Lost some incredible people in this church and people associated with our church. People that lived kind of back. I hope you grab the spirit of this message, that maybe you didn't even realize how much our society has flipped and we've just been manipulated, that this is what brings happiness. And it wasn't that long ago that in this country it wasn't that way. In our current trend, the discontentment will continue to just get greater and greater because we're pushing God farther and farther away in our homes, in our churches. It's pushing it away. And it's people like Fred and Delora, like your husband, Johnny Campos. And I don't see Phil and Debbie here this morning. Mary Jo, from Louisiana, and her husband, Al, thank you, the McKinneys. They had things, but things didn't own them. They owned them. They didn't possess them. They didn't control them. And we don't realize what has happened, that those people who would invest in prayer and invest in the house of God were faithful, how much they meant to us. And the Bible talks of a mantle. It was a cloth. And in particular, it was when Elijah was getting ready to leave this world. Elisha said, I want what you have, but I don't just want what you have. I want a double portion. I wish there would be a spirit in this church that would say, I want a double portion of what the rich people of this church had. I intended to have a cloth if I was going to do this. But when Al McKinney passed from this life and went away, his influence and his mantle fell to the ground. When Johnny, who made t-shirts, touched everybody, it didn't matter if he was going to sell you a shoe, whatever it was, he was going to talk about Jesus, and he was going to pray, and if he felt something in the moment, it didn't matter, he was going to pray. And on January 23rd, a mantle fell. February 3rd, 10:30 in the evening, life left Fred and a mantle fell. Wouldn't it be a tragedy if those mantles just laid dormant? In closing, I want to pray that this message is inspired to someone to say, I'm done buying the world's value and I'm ready to pick up a mantle. And I believe it's not one. If there are many people that want to pick up Johnny Campos' mantle, oh, it would be wonderful to have that prayer ministry, that t-shirt ministry, just revived through this place. Your father-in-law, Sabir, a mantle dropped, and I don't know if anybody picked it up. I didn't even understand the mantle. He was always bringing me picture frames with pictures of something he had cut out, and he was so inspired. He would walk over to this, and we'd picking up rocks, and he'd just pick up rocks, and he'd be here. Somebody got to pick up the mantle. But you know what you have to do to pick up the mantle? You got to lay down. You got to let go of some of this world, because you can't hold both. And you got to decide which one's more valuable, the things of this world or the things of heaven. Lord, as we close this morning, we're going to sing this song as we exit. But I pray, Lord, that we reevaluate our hearts on this Valentine's Day. That we evaluate where we're putting our treasures and what is the most relevant things. And help us to own things instead of things owning our lives and manipulating us, that we've got to have this and our kids got to be a part of this and our lives have to have that. God, help us to shut off the noise of the lies that this is what success means in this world, and help us come back to the richness of some of the men and women that you've taken away from us. I pray that somebody will pick up the mantle, that somebody will pick up a conviction, that something changes today in somebody's life at this church, on our online audience, that they become. We got to have another Fred Graham. We've got to have another Johnny Campos. We've got to have another Al McKinney. We got to have another Sabir. Got to have another Rex Frederick. And their mantles, are they laying dormant because we're chasing the wrong things? Jesus, forgive us. Forgive us of mixed up priorities, values. We're not bad people. We're not evil people. We just got lost. We just get overwhelmed sometimes by the bright lights. So draw us back today on this day of love to the one who loved us more than any, that robed himself in flesh, dwelled among us, became our perfect sacrifice, who invested everything for us, his very life, his very breath, who took nails in his hands and his feet and a thorn of crowns on his head, because he said, "You are the most precious thing." Help us come back to that and to the understanding, the knowledge that it's all in you, Jesus. The fullness of the Godhead, it's all in you. The peace that passes all understanding, it's all in you. The joy that will flood our spirit is all in the power of the Holy Spirit. Return this church, these people. In Jesus' name.